know what I'm asking? Because I have a Mac.
Okay, I heard there's something for a Mac. I heard there's something for a Mac.
Oh, okay.
What is this? This looks Mac-ish.
It is Mac-ish. It's white, it's Mac. So.
It's white, so it's Mac.
Just like.
Hey, when you place your laptop, put it a bit further away because of the camera.
Really? Right.
Yeah.
Wherever you want.
Let me just figure out presentation. That sucks. This won't work. This will work. Yeah, okay. Seems ready. We still have like 5 minutes anyway, so. What's that? I can actually move. Ah, let me try that. I have no idea how that works. So.
I suppose it's plug and play.
Yeah. Except. No. It should work.
It's not plug and play on Mac.
I guess I'll just use the case.
You have first?
Yeah. He's gonna go first.
Yo, first to your okay.
Because, yeah.
Move on some of these shares in the first line. It's usually when they
Right, I'm lost. You have too complex organization.
What?
You have too complex organization. Should I do like quick introduction, like as in welcome here to like SkyPicker meetup or?
I don't know, I have no idea.
I don't have idea either because I'm not from SkyPicker, right?
I know you're not. I just said, I just typed in SkyPicker because the majority of you guys are going to SkyPicker, so I was like, all right, it's titled SkyPicker.
Let me welcome to SkyPicker meetup. I'm not from SkyPicker.
Yeah, okay.
Sounds just about fine.
I'm not from SkyPicker, but. Anyway, I'm going to tell you something.
That is not SkyPicker related. Awesome.
Oh, we're going to start in 2 minutes.
Yeah, fine.
I think we're going to go without a microphone.
Did you announce that you will start in like 3 minutes because of live stream?
Why?
It's live stream, so people don't get bored from live stream. Okay.
This live streamed really.
Yes, okay, perfect.
everyone, can you guys sit down? Everyone find their place, sit down, because we're going to start really soon, in like 30 seconds time.
I mean, does this thing work or does it need turning on?
I have no idea, actually.
No.
Can you talk about
it? Test.
Who put it on you?
What?
Who put it on you?
The guy.
That guy?
Yeah.
No.
Okay. No. Or you did. Okay, I'm lost.
All right.
So it's working.
It's fine.
Okay.
Guys, welcome. All right. Just kill me. All right, guys. Welcome to another PyBelgrade meetup. I know it's Slava today, so a lot of you guys haven't come, but while you're digging into that meet, we're going to be digging into Python versus Golang, which is going to be our first presenter, Martin, here next to me, and he's going to tell us why you should do Python, why you should do Golang, pros and cons. So
yeah, great, thank you. So let me welcome you to this SkyPicker.io. I'm Martin and I'm not from SkyPicker. I'm from Red Hat actually. So in this talk I want to go over like the difference between Python and Golang, and very quick poll for the beginning, like who uses Python around here? Have your hand up. And who uses Go? Keep your hand up. That's actually awesome. So Python versus Go. The languages are actually quite similar. I mean, there's a bit more boilerplate in the Go, but as you can see, both languages lack semicolons, both languages look kind of similar, really very similar languages, at least syntactically. Now...
Sorry, can you use this?
Yeah.
Try it.
I'm trying it and it's not working, I guess. Test. Well, it's actually working. So... I mean, why should you consider Go? So you're most likely a Python developer and you're looking for something else to try. So why Go? So there are things such as type system, which is actually good in Go. It's very similar to like C language type systems, but it's not that intrusive. It actually compiles most of the time, which is awesome. There are interfaces which the only thing they do is they allow you to do duck typing correctly. So when you have interface, I mean, in Python, you have your interfaces actually in your head. So you expect the object to define multiple methods. Actually, in Go, you can do this by interface, so we can enforce it. Yeah, the syntax is similar. And actually, Go is extremely performant language. It's compiled to machine code. It's not running in virtual machine or any kind of interpreting machine or code. So that is awesome. And the main thing why you should try Go is if you're writing concurrent programs. So it's actually not that nice. I mean, it sounds nice, but like, for example, the type system. I mean, some of us chose Python because it does not have type system. So why the hell would I want to use a language with type system? So that's for some people. Also, the language is very terse. There's only like 25 keywords up to this date. And one like very specific thing is that you normally have for, while, sometimes even like do, until, do, while. Go only has for. So that's an example of its terseness. It also doesn't have generics, which is kind of annoying with its type system. But you can generate them, and that's where it gets really tricky and it gets really Go-ish. But if you want generics, you have to like write code in comments that actually generates it for all the types you need it for. Or you can actually abuse the type system and use so-called empty interface. And actually that's an interface which any like object satisfies. And one thing I spoke about performance. Actually you have Cython. And Cython is awesome because Cython is really fast if you can write in it. So that can help you a bit like the transition. About package management, and that is one area where Go lacks. Because in Python, most of the time you just need pip install some version, you have your requirements file, you have virtual environments, it kind of pretty much works together. With Go, you have to define your imports that are usually linked directly to GitHub in your code, and you have to run go-get to fetch them. Now that's tricky if you require some specific version, someone changes something, for example, if you had left pet in Go and someone changed left pet package, it would actually break your Go compilation. So that's not exactly nice. And this is actually being worked on. And since Go version 1.5, Google is actually working on fixing that thing with vendor testing equals one, but that's very internal again. Now, about libraries, as you know, Python is so rich that you can actually like import anything in Python. If you want machine learning, you can pretty much just like import machine learning because the package probably exists. If you need like numerical computations, there's NumPy. If you need IRC bot, if you need Slack bot, like everything exists in Python. In Go, this is a bit trickier because there's not as many packages, and the worst thing is they have an approach pretty much the same as Go developers do, that they don't break backwards compatibility in their libraries. And that kind of leads to a very, you know, old code being mixed with new code and not exactly nice libraries. There's link for it if you want to look at it. There's quite a lot of them. One thing that I really love about Go is that there's awesome HTTP server. It's very high performance. It's built into the language, and it's actually what like Google recommends using. So that's one pro of it. So tooling is very similar. We have Python with lots of things, but it's the ecosystem is kind of, you know, split. It's not very unified because you have Pep8, you have Pylint, then you have the REPL itself, you have IPython, PyTest, NoseTest. Everyone uses whatever he wishes. Well, in the comparison, you know, Go has like everything built in. You build your code by Go build, you test it by Go test, you get the dependencies by Go get, and there's no like different tools if you want Pylint, if you want Pep8, if you want whatever is it, like your favorite linter. So it's actually very unified, and you know, Go language has you backed up in this regard. That is nice. Yeah, syntax. It's mostly the same actually, except it's not really object oriented. You have structures that look like objects in Python. You have lists and slices that's very similar to Python. There's difference in memory management, but if you were to go with Go, you would most likely study that. One thing that is great, and I really like that in Python, is select. And Go select is able to select from multiple things. It can select based on type, it can select based on value, it can select based on which channel is available, more on it later. And that is really strong thing compared to Python, where you actually don't have select at all, except for the Unix select. But like in the language, you have nothing like that. The runtime, yeah, the like biggest difference is that Go is not dynamic. So you don't really have any code, hot swapping, any hacking of the dynamic runtime. You can't really have like decorators hacking the functions. Kind of, I like it in Python, but it's not exactly maintainable code, so, you know, not exactly great. One thing, which is like Go's main objective, is concurrency. Actually, parallelism, but that's up to later. And for comparison, we have Python, and we have like software written in Python 2.7. Most of you think that's ancient, but like most of the Python software is actually in 2.7. And concurrency or parallelism barely exists there. You most likely have to use multiprocessing, which is just annoying. It's so complex to run two things simultaneously that most people just like don't do it or just use UWSGI with Unicorn or any other library. In Python 3.4 and 3.5, we actually still have like GIL, so we can't use threading directly for concurrency, but we have AsyncIO. AsyncIO is actually a really great library, except for a few things. Just if you don't know, AsyncIO's main objective or the idea is to have event loop in the language. So event loop is a thing that's running in one thread, and it actually schedules its own software threads. These are not really mapped to system level threads. These are only running in software. What that means is that you can, when you have an IO bound application or IO bound processes, you can really schedule multiple these simple processes If they block, you just reschedule to different one. And that way you can like assume concurrency in application that is IO bound. One problem with AsyncIO in Python is that it doesn't really fit the language. If you have tried it, then you will notice really a lot of awkward functions. It totally doesn't feel Pythonic, and you will see that like in a second. In 3.5, the Python developers have actually really improved it by having like async dev, which defines coroutine, which is the software thread, and standard like await. And previously we had like yield from and AsyncIO coroutine decorator. And there's also like performance difference between Python and Go still. Like Go is way faster, 3 times or so. The performance problem, if you've kind of kept up with internet's last days, it's not true because there was some magic IO block announced UV loop, which is like drop-in replacement for the event loop. That actually, according to their data, I have not tried it because it was released like 3 days ago. It reaches Go-like speeds, so we could solve that. But for the syntax awkwardness, we have like a standard get event loop. That's I could live with that. Then we have run until complete, still fine. Then we have like call soon and call later. Like, yeah, sure. What is soon? What is later? I honestly don't know. It just doesn't make too much sense. Run forever. You actually have to have run forever in most of your AsyncIO programs because how else do you keep the program running? So we have run forever. That's actually catching like keyboard interrupt or anything where it actually stops the run forever. So that's just like weird. And await is actually fine. And this is the coroutine definition, so that's actually fine. You just write async def instead of def. That is really nice. One thing when you're running concurrent or multiprocess application is you have to synchronize all of it. Unless you're doing really, separated accesses, you usually have some shared state, shared data, something that needs to be protected and access to it needs to be synchronized. In Python, you have pretty much the same primitives as in threading systems. So you have logs, you have conditional variables, semaphores. A lot of people don't like these. I don't like these. It's kind of hard to follow at some points. And it really sounds like threading. I don't feel like I'm dealing with asynchronous IO, just like threading in different syntax. This in Go is kind of solved in a very nice way. There's no special definition for function that is coroutine. You have your standard functions, whatever they are called, whatever they do. If you want the function to be run asynchronously, you just like run it as gofunc. That's all you have to do. That function is now running asynchronously in your environment, which is like totally awesome. You don't have to have any run until complete and run forever loops calling soon and later. There are also channels for synchronization, and that's like topic for almost whole presentation, so I won't go too deep into that. But it kind of allows us to avoid all the threading clocking primitives, because channels are really what they mean. They're either half duplex or duplex. They allow you to communicate values. And you can pass channels easily between coroutines, and then you pass values that you actually need to synchronize on. So you don't send value until you need to synchronize. So simple. Combined with the select, that can actually wait on the channels. So when you're writing like some asynchronous server, you can just have like multiple coroutines with their channels reporting data on the channels, select that selects from each channel. What that means is that when some channel has data available, it's selected by the Go runtime, it's used, and you're looping again. Perfectly clear, fast, not a lot of boilerplate code compared to Python. About parallelism, that's a very tricky thing in Python because normally you would need processes in Python. In Go, this is kind of hidden from you in the runtime because they don't really want you to know how many like processors you're running on. The Go runtime only wants you to care about your coroutines, about the logic. Though, if you really need to have some kind of parallelism, there's GoMax Prox variable that you can set to, like, set how many processor cores are actually available for the coroutine scheduling. In Python, that's import multithreading. Good luck with that. So it all looks cool, but should you actually switch? And I mean, it depends. It depends really on the project, on the developers, on you, if you feel like it, if you like Go. Because, yeah, for if you're working in a project that already exists and is written in Python 2.7, it definitely makes sense to consider switching to Go. On the other hand, if you have project written in like Python 3.4, 3.5, I mean, switching wouldn't bring you too much because you already have the code base, you're familiar with it, developers definitely love it. Why switch, right? It becomes even trickier for new projects. And I was trying to think of rule of thumb to present in this presentation, and I actually couldn't find one. So if this presentation actually like made you try Go, awesome. Go write something nice in Go. But I can't guarantee that you will like it. Most likely not. Because for simple scripts, Python is still better. It's like faster. You can prototype rapidly in it. Perfect. Huge applications. Go, on the other hand, works finer with teams. In between, it depends on you. So that's my presentation. In my opinion, the dark side, the Go side, can wait. So thank you. Right. The biggest reason for me would be interfaces, because I'm writing or I'm working on a very large Python code base, and we are getting burned by duck typing all the time because we assume some kind of state or some kind of attributes of objects, and then we realize, well, they're not there, and we only find this out when it actually occurs because it's dynamic. We don't find it out, you know, before trying it. So that would be my biggest reason why would I go with Go in a large project. Right. Just really code performance-wise, I don't think so, because we're dealing with like interpreted language against compiled language. On the other hand, as we discussed, I think we're approaching like an age where the performance itself is not that critical, and we can actually have microservices, we can have many of them, instead of having one monolithic Go application that would be blazing fast. Just easier to have small Python applications, right? But just really runtime wise, no way.
Thank you. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Martin. All right, that was Martin. Up next, we have a guy who had a problem to solve. He had an issue with scanning multiple receipts. He solved it by using OCR, and he's gonna show us how he solved that problem.
I might have some technical issues because I just installed new Arch Linux and not everything is working. So we will see if it works. Because I just realized I don't have most of the types. So is it WGA? I don't think I can. No.
Wait.
Yeah, but I cannot switch it because it's too manual, and yeah, That's too bad. That's very bad. Okay. Do you have Ethernet here? Ethernet cable?
I'm not really sure. Jokichu, do we have Ethernet cable? Ethernet cable.
What's a cable?
Ethernet cable. Cable to this part. Yeah, because I just need to install a few apps. Oh, yeah, my internet is not working here, so.
Okay, is there any way they can switch to the. Maybe Jiří, can you pick it up while we. Can you pick it up the second conversation while he handles the issue?
Yeah, perhaps.
Alright, so Jiří is gonna.
Yeah, so
Jiří is gonna give us a talk about WebSockets right now, how he solved the solution, how he solved the problem with WebSockets, because we all know. Everyone who's ever done anything with WebSockets in Python knows that it doesn't have a really clean solution to it. Well, Django does actually recently, but before we didn't have a clean solution for WebSockets. Jiří is going to tell us a solution, and he's going to show us how he did it.
Okay.
Okay. Oh. Hi. So, WebSockets. How many of you did implement WebSockets sometime? Oh. So, for others, what is WebSockets? It's a lightweight protocol over TCP for full duplex communication between client, which is web browser, and server. Why to use it? Sometimes we want to have our application rich, some interaction put it in there. So, for example, for games or some notifications, some more user interrogation. For example, Google spreadsheets, you want to edit more users at the same time. So you want to have legs and this. So the previous solution was to use polling, which has lots of overhead because you have to ask server periodically for some updates. But with this duplex communication, you can send data both ways anytime. So browser support. Internet Explorer supports is from version 10, Chrome from version 4, and like this. So nowadays support isn't that bad, but for older browsers, you had to fall back to polling, or Socket.io has implemented something in Flash, some ugly solution, which is faster and better than polling. So there is some graph of polling. Yeah, on the left, in the middle is SSI protocol, which establish connections and can stream from server to to Explorer. And the third graph is for WebSockets. You establish communication, and you can communicate both ways anytime. So WebSockets supports text or binary data transfers. When the connection is established via HTTP, you can choose sub-protocols, some extensions, and version and modify it. If you set it, it can be faster, this initialization. You can use TLS for secured transfer. It also fixes some issues with some magic with switching versions in the middle of the communication. You can set your cross-origin policy. Web browsers implements cloaking for disabling modification of the message queue, which could have malicious depends. Okay. The other aspect of the protocol is when you send very big message, like some image or something, it's split into chunks through frames, and and the browser put it into the queue and blocks other messages. So if you send like 10 megabytes or 20 megabytes image, it can block other communication from WebSockets. So you can implement some solution to split the message first and put it together back on the backend on the server. When you send from the browser message, it can come to the server in different order, because there is a queue in the browser which can vary. So to ensure it, you can modify the payload, add some identifier, or you can just subscribe to the browser queue, and when it's empty, you can send your next message. Well, the WebSocket API supports some extensions, because by default, for example, it doesn't support multiplexing. If you want to establish more socket more connections, you have to also have more TCP connections. So there is an extension for multiplexing, which doesn't have good support yet. There is also extension for data compression, which is on Andrew's slide. And we have with this protocol some problems. One of them might be caching. It doesn't cache by default, so we have to solve it on your side somehow. Issue can be if you send to the browser more images, you transfer all of the data, so you can send only a hash of it and cache it. there can be, for example, problem with delivery, because you don't really know if the message comes. So you have to implement some solution if you want to do it. Also, from the server side, there can be a problem with timeouts on load balancers, edge proxies, and stuff like this. So you might need to set up timeouts correctly, not to cut the connection. And another aspect of it are mobile devices. It usually makes sense to use it, but if you don't have very low traffic or overhead, it could deplete your battery if you have many socket connections. Well, message compressions. There are two approaches. The old one to compress each frame of the message, which was replaced by compression of the whole message. But the support is still not good. I think it's only in Safari and Chrome. You can save some bandwidth, but you have CPU and memory overhead. So there is establishing of it. You establish the protocol, and there are few aspects of it. There is problem that if you want to use it, client compresses everything, even binary data, which already can be compressed, which is overhead. But on the other side, the backend can choose which message will compress and which not. You can set how much memory you want to use for the compression or CPU, like that. Here is some JavaScript syntax of socket API. There are a few events for receiving errors, for closing connections, for sending messages. Sending method is usually very fast. You just put the message to the queue of the browser, and it gets success. And you can't rely that the message will be delivered eventually. So implementations, we have some frameworks over the WebSockets. The most common in JavaScript is Socket.io, which has also Node.js implementation and fallbacks over polling and this ugly flash solutions. There is also Soc.js, which has backend in Node.js, Tornado. This is being prepared in several more languages. And in Python, you can use frameworks like Twisted, Tornado, Gevent, and lightweight, less known, IO HTTP. Well, I have chosen two examples I have implemented. The one was like 3 years ago in my previous company. We have developed some help desk for the deaf people. People that didn't hear and needed to call to ambulance or hospital or to their friends, and they just couldn't. So we needed a help desk. We had operators that could type fast and knew the hand language. And there was like video calls. Operator could call to the hospital. And also real-time chat with people who need. So one use case was somebody wanted to call to the hospital. He signed it, and he got to the operator who called to the hospital, and in real-time they could type. WebSockets were really useful because when you typed, the operator saw a letter when it was typed. So there weren't lags in communication, which would be pretty bad if you wait 5 minutes for finishing the message and have ambulance on call. We had there some notification systems and other socket stuff. It was implemented in Tornado. We chose it because 3 years ago we had a problem to get some framework that supported Socket.io. Socket.io had fallbacks for polling and this flash solution. And in Python was everything outdated, so we found Tornado with some outdated version of Socket.io, and we used it. And with the fallbacks, we could support many of web browsers. It also had to be reliable. It will be bad if you miss or throw away some messages. So we implemented some solution to gather all the messages and to be sure that it's in the same order and that you don't miss anything. This is the first one, and in SkyPicker we had to implement it WebSockets, because when you come to the booking page where you want to order some flight, we have like 1,000 airlines and their data, and the price of the flight can change like several times in an hour, and you don't know when. And the our front end had to ask back end like every 10 seconds if something changed. So we implemented WebSockets when our servers and data centers pushed through the Redis queue updates of the prices and if the flight is still available. And when the issue came, web browser was notified instantly, and user knew that there is something wrong. We needed to handle a lot of load. We needed some low-level fast solution, so we chose Python 3 and IO HTTP, which is lightweight and pretty simple. We didn't need some fallbacks and compatibility because our front end doesn't support all the web browsers anyway. So there is some example. It's basically just IO loop with AsyncIO. You set up a server and subscribe to Redis queue and Websockets. So that's all. Oh yes, it will take like 5 minutes.
is your code open source?
No. Yeah, sorry.
It's but never going to be open source, at least that part.
If you want, we can put it open source, I guess. Or. Well, we didn't have to scale that because it didn't have much of load and everything was smooth so far. So, sorry.
SkyPicker, Jozef Képesi, if we can find him. He doesn't have anything really prepared for him, so I'm just going to put like a little banner. Jozef. Okay, so Jozef is going to do a little introduction on SkyPicker. If he makes it out of the kitchen or the toilet. Let me put on some music. Okay, let me see what the problem is. So, like you heard, our main talks of the day are going to be guys from SkyPicker, and I don't know, how many of you guys have heard about SkyPicker? How many of you guys have heard about Jozef?
Hey!
Alright, so, should I take a seat? Do it.
What the fuck?
Oh, thank you. So which one should I use?
Both. Oh.
Okay, this doesn't work?
It works, for my mom.
How the fuck do you turn this off? Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, can you hear me there?
What?
Yeah. So first of all, do you have the presentation ready, Bojan? You have it on your email, so fuck you.
No, really, no, I don't have it.
Yeah, you have it.
No, I don't. Yeah, I have the presentation.
Ah, you have it on your email.
Really? Until then,
how the fuck should I still look at the presentation?
Nothing. Sorry, it's just gonna be a
gap. This is useless.
Alright.
HDMI or something there? Really don't have it. Fuck you, man. Fuck. Yeah, just send me the HDMI. Gracias. Still broken, man.
Ah, it works. It's a notch. No, it doesn't work.
So fix it.
It's on your end.
No, it's a MacBook. It works.
It's a MacBook, okay, so you need that one. You need that one.
What should I do now?
Is it on?
Yes. Like, really, what the fuck?
Should you can you mail me?
Yes, if you have internet here. Can just switch it to HDMI, maybe.
I'm not sure it works. Oh, there it is.
Yeah, great. Nice. Okay, so everybody can hear me, yeah? It's fine. I don't have to yell. Great. So first of all, sorry for being late and sorry for the mess here. I got lost in Belgrade. It's a huge city. It's awesome. First of all, I'm from SkyPicker. I'm the current CTO there, one of the co-founders. A few people mentioned already they know SkyPicker. So who knows SkyPicker? Oh, it's not too much, okay? So SkyPicker is a flight ticket search engine and also a travel agent or a flight ticket booking engine. So you can buy airline tickets with us. And we don't say we can get you the cheapest airline tickets to anywhere for any time. But for some cases, we can cut down the price by 50%, which is which is fucking awesome. SkyPicker is at the same time processing hundreds of terabytes of airline data monthly or maybe already daily. And we are selling thousands of tickets per day, which is quite huge, a lot of data. And you need to handle it on the technical side somehow. So you need Python or C. This is how it looks like. There is a map, which is, everybody says it's fucking awesome. And there is some inspiration search, like you can go to Oslo or Warsaw or Sandefjord or whatever, just because it's cheap, so, or you can. About the company, it's a quite interesting history because it was founded like 3 or 4 years ago in 2013. There was three of us, me, the current CEO, and the investor. 1 year ago, there was 30 employees, so nearly like zero. Nowadays, it's 600. So we grew a lot in the past year, and yeah, it went crazy. SkyPicker has something like flight ticket search API. So we have a public API where you can search for flight tickets. The API is able to do handle searches like I want to fly from Belgrade to anywhere in the world. So to Madrid, to London, you just tell us anywhere. We will give you the cheapest option. And also you can tell us I want to fly anytime. So tell me the date when the tickets are the cheapest ones. This API, anybody know Sky, Commodore, Skyscanner? Anybody who is traveling knows these websites because you just use them for comparing ticket prices, and they have our API implemented, which means it does quite a huge load. It does 30 million daily searches, including the crazy anywhere anytime searches. But we can keep the average response time under one second, and at the same time we have to slow down some searches because it can boost the conversion. The response time in general is under 100 milliseconds, not on the 1 second. We also have something, some huge data processing framework under the API, but I won't speak about it nowadays or today. And the whole SkyPicker infrastructure is running on a hybrid cloud. It's Amazon combined with 200, maybe already 300 bare metal servers. And the whole infrastructure is managed by a DevOps team of 3 people, which is fucking awesome because they have Ansible, so they are able to do it. Today, I would like to speak about Postgres, which is, I found it nowadays an awesome framework for working with data. It's not a database anymore. It's not something like MySQL or Taku or MongoDB or whatever. Anybody using Postgres here? Well, you should use Postgres. We were using Postgres for 2 years. In 2014 and 15, we switched there from MySQL because we found out it doesn't really scale well. And we learned a lot during the 2 years. Then we have to leave Postgres because we had to write our own database in C++ and Go. But we learned a lot, and we learned it the hard way. And I will tell you about a few tricks, hints, and things we found out people just don't know about Postgres, even if it's in the documentation. So you can read it there, and you can just use it anytime. But there are a few caveats that are not in the documentation, and you should be aware about it. We were really focusing on the performance with Postgres because we were writing the database quite a lot of data, and we had to read the reads for scaling like doubled each month. So we were just adding slaves. And in general, if you don't know what to use or which kind of database to use, in SkyPicker there is a rule: if you're in doubt, just fucking use Postgres. Don't like choose anything else, just use Postgres. And also, we found out that if you are really doing some big data analysis or some big data science, that means petabytes of data, there is no better combination maybe than Postgres or some Elasticsearch maybe. But Postgres combined with analytical DB, which is Vertica, Snowflake, Redshift, whatever. You can run this database in cloud and do some computations, but then you don't want to run production on these databases because they are fucking expensive. You just want to do the computation and shut them down. If you compare this solution with Hadoop or Cassandra, it's 10 times cheaper and maybe 5 or 10 times faster for our use case, because we did some comparisons and it was fucking faster. And also, what we found out in the meantime, as we were running bare metal cloud and so on, you have to avoid cloud. It's not cool to say nowadays, but you have to do it to get a really huge performance. How we found out these things, or what I'm going to speak about, is going to be like 10 slides. Randomly, we fucked everything up. If there was something to fuck up, we did it. But we multiplied the performance in a few months, like 6 times, from 50 million writes and nearly 75 million writes per minute. I'm not sure if there is some company doing that much writes, except Facebook or Google or something like that. It's quite a lot. Yeah, so we just learned it the hard way. In general, every developer should know some basic rules about the database, like please put your index here, and please write your, like, don't use RM. Anybody is using RM here? Don't do it. The RM will slow you down. If you are building an application that has to scale, like really fast, super fast, you have to avoid this. Like, it makes your code super simple, but at the same time, it will make your DevOps like cry, and it will wake them up every night. How do you optimize your database? You run some explain for your select queries or for your queries in general. You see what is happening there. Everybody knows what does explain do, yeah? How does it work? It will tell you what are you doing wrong. So you do the changes, you change your select, or you change the database configuration based on what you're trying to achieve, and then you just buy a better hardware because you will find out your hardware sucks. And then you go back to the changes. And as I mentioned, the only thing, if you are growing like crazy, like 1,000 times in a year, your database just has to scale. It has to be fucking stable, because each like 1 hour of the downtime can cost you thousands of euros, just not in revenues, but in profit. And it has to recover fast, because if something goes wrong, it's going to be like huge. It's not like, hey, my database just failed, I need to start it again. No. Your cluster is just fucked up, and now you are not going to sleep today and tomorrow. Anybody knows how does Postgres scale, or how does it handle scaling? Okay, it scales well.
Faster.
No, it doesn't even exist for Postgres. Like, it's some better version. You don't want to use it in production. Like Mongo doesn't scale as well, or it really sucks at scaling. If you want to scale your database, you have always the best option is just try to not to scale the writes, but scale the reads. So in our case, it was the search requests. Hey, I want to fly from here, from there, blah, blah, blah. Okay, we had to all the time our search requests were growing. So we were doing the classical replication. It was streaming replication, and it was working quite fine for like one more month or 2 weeks maybe. We had a master server, there was a 1 gigabyte network, and it was sending the files four or five masters, and they were doing their reads. And then some new partner like CAC launched the market like US, and then we were like, okay, now we have to fix it somehow. This doesn't scale really well until you don't find a really good server provider which can give you 10 gigabytes of network. Which is not really usual today or nowadays. What you can do or how you can fix it in Postgres is to do cascaded replication. So we will skip the slaves, and you will add an additional layer of servers, and they will create the slaves. So there will be some servers only acting as a proxy and forwarding the data to slaves. You have to get them with the 10 gigabytes of network if you're going to do really heavy writes, because otherwise it's going to be broken. This way you can scale really fast, but it has some limits, and that's why we had to leave Postgres and do our own search database, because it had some limits. Everybody understands the concept of cascaded replication? No. Okay, in classical replication, you have one master server, and you're connecting the slaves. Each slave is downloading like 100 megabytes of data, but the limit is the 1 gigabyte network. So you can connect only 4 or maybe 5 slaves and keep them like synced. If you are fully loading the network, now how do you add 10 slaves? You can't add them because they are going to be out of sync after some time. So you add this additional layer of 10 gigabyte network. It's just a proxy, and it's forwarding the wall files. So you are sending from the master server, you are sending the files to 2 or 3 servers, and you can forward them to like 10 additional, 20 additional servers. So it's some boost, but it's not like unlimited boost. Nowadays, we haven't found any real solution for master-master replication for Postgres, or we found some, but it was broken. There is CitusDB. Anybody know CitusDB? Okay, there are some cool kids. 6 months ago, they were not so cool, but now they released the 1.0.0 version. It's a Postgres-like extension, and it acts as, it works as Elasticsearch. You just add a new server, and it will handle the scaling. So it is just adding servers to the cluster, and you don't have to care about anything. It just works. If you haven't tried in production, because we already left Postgres, but if anybody is going to handle a lot of data for writes, I would go nowadays for the CitusDB, not for just a classical Postgres. Anyway, if you're working on optimization on the level like, I need to really get each 1% of performance for my writes, you care about the hardware. You can't stay on Amazon because the IO there is really unstable, and if you get a bad neighbor, which will fuck up your server IO, it's really unpredictable. So it will work like this, randomly. You don't want to have it on production. There is a cloud, it's called Gevent. One instance is they're fucking expensive, but it worked really well, or it seemed to be working fine, and they were able to adjust even the size of the, how do you call it, the RAID array, the bytes, or the block size in the RAID array, which is the last thing you can do when you're optimizing the hardware. Also, there is a rack space and some PCI SSD, which is the maybe the best one you can get. And there is one thing regarding the hardware, if you are focusing on the performance, SSDs have a feature that the performance goes like this after 1 week, just drops. And it wakes up your operations team and they don't know what to do. So yeah, and nobody knows about this. SSDs, or most of the SSD disks, if you put them in a RAID array, 1, 0, 10, or 5, it doesn't matter, they have something like a feature that the performance is going to fuck up totally, like close to zero. It's because if you're doing 24/7 writes, they are not just built for this. There are a few types of FSDs which don't have this feature, or the drop is like not so drastic. And it's Intel 3700 or 3700, and maybe one or two more. But most of the SSDs are going to die after 24/7, after 1 or 2 weeks, like total. So you have to care about this if you are going to use some bare metal servers and buy some hardware, because it's not the cheapest one what you are doing there. Regarding this replication, the cascaded replication, I can have as much layers as I want of these proxy servers that are just forwarding data. I can have 3 layers of them and just have 100 slave servers which are actually reading the data at the end. But it has some pros and cons. So it has some delay, because if I will have 5 layers of these proxy servers or 10 gigabyte servers, each of them will add like 10 seconds or 2 to 10 seconds of delay. And I need to handle this in my application, so the application won't expect real-time data. So if I write something on the master, I can't expect to have it immediately on the slaves. I need to like count with some delay. On the other side, nobody cares or nobody gives a fuck, because it's chaos. And what can you do here? It was last thing we found out. Just run the slaves on a RAM disk, or just put all the data in the memory. If you lose them, it doesn't matter, because it's a slave and you can rebuy the slave in like 1 hour. And if you have 100 of them, like, okay, please die. Let me work. In general, this replication or the scaling works quite good. But if you screw something up, it's a huge party, because you can't really automate failover and anything here with Ansible. There are some tools for this, but in case you have a network outage, you just don't want some tool to say, hey, I'm going to do a failover because I can't ping the master for 1 minute. Doesn't mean it's that. It can mean the network is like, or some router is not working, and it will work in 1 minute. So we have to do this in semi-auto way, and somebody has to approve it. Like, okay, I'm going to do the failover. It always does something you don't want to see in production. Also, if you have a lot of slaves, please don't forget to monitor the delay there, because they are always downloading some files, but there is some delay, 2 seconds, 10 seconds, but the delay can go up to 10 hours. You have to know about this, that the slave has some old data which doesn't really reflect the reality. It's totally like something different. In case we had the flight prices there, after 1 week we found out that half of the slaves had 1 hour all data, the prices were totally different. So each user saw some price change. Hey, this price is old, fuck off, pay us more. And in general, 1 gigabyte of the network, which is now the classical network, not the super one, it's really slow. You need to get 10 gigabytes to work with a lot of data. That's the best thing you can do if you want to scale your application in Postgres. Now, there is some additional features you can use in Postgres. I'm not sure if anybody is aware of them. They're really cool, so I'm just going to go one by one there, and I can explain them more in detail if somebody will be interested. Anybody knows what's stable partitioning? I'm asking this on the interviews. Nobody knows. it means that if I have a huge table, like 1 billion of rows, I can split it in small tables. Each of them will have 100 million of rows. And Postgres, if I run a select query there, Postgres is able to run the select or read the tables in parallel, which is quite a huge performance if there is a solid SSD RAID array, which is able to read like 1 gigabyte of data per second. It's a game changer. It can boost your selects like 10 times. It depends on the sharding key you will choose and so on, but it's like really a turbo or super speed. There is partial indexes, so your memory is limited and you want to keep your indexes as small as possible, so that's why you choose correct data types, and that's why you don't index everything. Partial indexes in Postgres or in general in databases, they mean, hey, there is some true and false values, I want to index on the true values. MS SQL and Postgres handle this differently. If you do the select queries in MS SQL, you can't ask for the false values if you index the true ones. I'm not sure. Whatever. it's good. Use it. If you know your select queries, do the partial indexes, don't index everything, or don't index the stuff you don't need to index. There is vacuum in Postgres. Anybody knows vacuum? Or why the fuck should it turn it off? Okay. So by the architecture how Postgres works, if you delete a row, it's not deleted. It just flagged as deleted, but it stays on the hard disk. So after deletion of 100 million rows, they are still on the hard disk, and it's eating up your disk space. And if you are using SSDs, today you have 300 gigabytes left on space, but after 1 week there is only 150 gigabytes, okay? After 2 weeks you're out of space, so why? because Postgres is built like that, and it's not really deleting the rows. They are still there on saved somehow. There is a feature which should handle this. It's called vacuum. It's going always through the database and deleting this stuff from the hard disk. But at the same time, it's eating up your performance. It can go up from 5 to 10% maybe. And if you're aiming for the performance, for like maximum performance of writes, you need to turn it off. Because 10%, it's a lot for just like deleting stuff. What the fuck? Use PG Repack. It's a tool that will do nothing else, like just create some triggers in the database. And each midnight, each 6 hours, each whatever, it will just build a totally new database, copying the data to a new scheme and leaving the deleted data there. After the whole table is copied, it will just drop the old scheme and move the new one and rename it. That's it. Nobody will notice it. It will just drop your performance for maybe 1 hour during not the peak hours. So you can set it as you need, and there will be just a slight performance error because it will be rebuilding the data, but...
There is synchronization issues with that.
Oh. What issues?
Once he's copying the schema from one location to the other, some synchronization issues might...
No, there is trigger, which is like adding all the new data you will write there, so it's not losing any data. No, it's not worth it. But we had a lot of deletes, so we had to do it. if you don't have deletes or you don't have a lot of updates, you don't have to do this. You just turn on the vacuum and watch the performance, how much performance it eats. In general, it's good to use vacuum. That's default stuff. But if you're doing heavy writes and heavy like deletes, updates, you need to have pgrepack. We have to run it each day. Maybe in general, it's best practice to run it once per week, once per month. I don't know. We have to run it each day, and after some time, it was each 12 hours before we dropped pg. Yes, because PG is scanning the rows like, hey, are you the correct row? Hey, are you the correct row? Hey, no, no. And you can do it in parallel with 10 tables, so it will ask 10 rows at the same time. Just need CPU for this, of course. But usually you have this. It's also a good idea to run analyze, which is a command in Postgres. I don't know if it's in any other database. We never try to find out what the fuck is it doing. It just writes some data and it's like does some analysis and it just improves the performance. We just had a cron job which was running analyze. Don't ask me why. Also, there is something called genetic query optimizer in Postgres. It's a really cool thing. How it works, it builds your it will do some A/B testing with your query. So, and always it will choose the fastest branch. So it will run it this way, and then it will try join to do some different way, and then it will pick the better one, and same time. If you are doing like millions of select queries per day, after a few hours, you can see really huge improvements in the performance. And the most easy stuff, just fucking don't use MySQL, even nowadays. There is a really cool thing about Postgres, which makes it now a framework, or more a framework than a regular database for selects and updates and some inserts. You have this FDV, or for, what's that? Remote Data Connector or something like this. It means I have a Postgres database, but I can ask, by selecting from Postgres database, I can ask MySQL database for data. At the same time, I can ask for some CSV file for the data, or I can even ask Mongo for data. And I can join the data in the Postgres and work with that. So I don't need any ETL, I don't need any data pumps, I don't need anything, I just need the Postgres. A CSV file can act as a database table, so I can do selects from a CSV file and joins at the same time. And it's a native feature in Postgres. But nobody is using that. I don't know why. I drew a picture for this. So I can use LDAP, CSV, MySQL, and do some kind of this select query so I can see my employees with salary higher as 1,000. And I don't need anything to connect my data. Postgres can do this for me. There are services for like downloading the data, some ETL. Now I need to clean the data. What the fuck? And now I will insert them in a Postgres database and do selects. You can do the cleaning in the SQL query or directly in the select query and just join it in the Postgres.
But it will be slower.
You don't care. It's some analytics stuff. You don't care if it will run for 1 minute or for 5 minutes usually. It's for reporting. It's really good for reporting, or it's not good for monitoring, of course, but for reporting, it's like awesome. You have this financial department. They are crazy about Excel, so they have a lot of CSVs. Okay, I will put them to the Postgres. And go away. Let me work. Just a quick mention about Multicorn. It's a Python module for working with these FDVs. It can access your file system, it can access your LDAP server and CSVs, and I think you can write your own connectors thanks to this module. It's done in Python, and I never used it. In general, when you're working with Postgres in Python, there is this PsychoPG library, but we found out a lot of people doesn't know you can run multiple queries in parallel if you're using gevent. So you just shoot a query, you run a thread for it, and you're just asking for the status of the query. It's done, it's not done. And Postgres just tells you it's done. And you can have 10 queries in parallel running at maybe multiple servers, and you just join or work with the data in your Python program. There is a link for, there is a live code, so you can just copy paste it and pretend you're super smart, you did it. Regarding the architecture, Postgres has some not so nice features, and the DevOps are not always aware about them. Just a few mentions about the software you should use together with Postgres. It's one of them is AJ Proxy. Anybody knows it, or everybody should know it. It's a load balancer. The most cool thing is it has a health check for PG. So if you want, if you are running 50 or 100 slave servers for reads, and 10 of them will die, you're just asking AJ proxy always for the selects. And AJ proxy just won't forward the select queries to that service. It will just drop them from the pool, and okay, nobody will notice anything. And it's super stable. You never saw it go down. It's something like Nginx, maybe even better. And you should use it combined with something which is called PG Bouncer. It's a really small sheet of software. It doesn't do anything, just connections. Truly doesn't know how to do anything. The case with Postgres is that creating a new connection is it's costly for the resources. And if you're doing thousands of them per second or per minute, it will eat a lot of your CPU, your memory, and of your everything. So you can buy better hardware or just optimize it via PG Bouncer. And if you connect PG Bouncer with AJ Proxy, you can have four PG Bouncer instances because it's single core. So if you have four CPU server, you need four PG Bouncers. And you put a AJ Proxy on top of these four PG Bouncers in balance of the, over them. And what they do is they do anything else. They just keep the connection with Postgres open. And instead of connecting the Postgres, you're connected the stupid PG Bouncer, which just accepts your connections, does some basic authentication, and forwards the query to Postgres. That's it. But it is doing it much better than Postgres itself. I don't know why. It's faster. In our case, it boosted the rise by 30%. So we were able to do not 50 million of rides, but 60 or 65 just by adding PG Bouncer to the architecture and combined with AJ Proxy, of course. Yeah. Anybody is using PG Bouncer in production? Wow. You guys really don't know how to use Postgres. We learned a lot from, there is a company called Vanellocom. I don't know if they still exist. But they did some really cool things with Postgres. They were able to optimize it like much more better than we did. And they have some 12-step program for scaling the web applications. You should check them, and you can just find it by typing Vanellocom to Postgres, to Google. Vanellocom Postgres optimization, and it will like show you the presentation. So, last slide, or yeah, last boring slide. What we learned in the past years in general, don't use MySQL, it will like kill you if you're going to grow. You don't need an ETL system or any data pumps if you know how to use the FDBs. Use PG Bouncer or AJ Proxy on top of Postgres, because it will just make your life better and faster. And nowadays, I would look for the CitusDB, which is the extension for Postgres, and it looks really awesome. And if you would still use Postgres, I'm sure we'll be already using CitusDB, only Postgres itself. I think that's it. It's still much slower than joint, let's say. They have some IOPs or something, but it's really low compared to anything else. Or it was, I'm not sure nowadays.
So AWS gives experimental as well. You try experimental on AWS. AWS gives you bare metal access to some of their machines.
Maybe. Well, because we had thousands of workers inserting data to Postgres, so what you can do is put a queue on top of Postgres and just select from the queue, or...
Why don't you keep the connection persistence?
Because... in a way. Because after the process will shut down, it will just close the connection, and we were running thousands of processes at the same time. That's thousands of connections.
Can I continue on that question? So basically, you open every time you connection to database.
Mm-hmm.
You don't use connection pool of any kind.
No, because you start a new process, like you're starting hundreds of processes each second, and when the process is done, you just close the connection.
Well, usually connection pools should, and in practice, what I've done, improve performance.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about 10,000 per minute or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been it up a lot. We don't use Postgres, we use Oracle, but and it should fit it up because the longest part is to create new connections. So the handshakes between database and new thread is a lot. In this case, pool always open new connections and just give you connection, like here is new. And
yeah, so
was to always have an open connection. Is there any particular reason that
maybe we were stupid.
I don't think so.
But PG Bouncer is what acted as the pool here, basically. And we had a queue on top of everything. So every process was basically at the end connecting to a Redis queue. And there was a static amount of workers inserting data. I'm not sure why we were not using some pool or something in the process.
One more question, and then I'm done. Use HA proxy to put a lot of bounds. Why don't you have a lot of connections, a lot of data to process? Why don't you use clusters?
What clusters?
Clusters, I don't know, for example, console or etcd or something like that.
Uh-huh.
To more load bounds, it's more stable in general because you don't care if some nodes go dead. H proxy is dead, he will check anyway. Is he dead? If he's dead, he needs to notify everyone else. No, he is dead, but I will.
Yeah.
And in a cluster, you always give you a pre-available node.
Yeah, because first it had some delay, and second we had AJ proxy balancing on top of four AJ proxies on the DNS level.
Okay.
Which did some health check.
And the first one, did
you deal with inserts or did you also have outlets?
Both of them.
And did you figure out why?
I couldn't hear you. Could you repeat it?
Why is Altis working with the link insert, even if it's a fixed size type like integer?
Why is Postgres deleting the row and creating a new one?
Yeah.
I know, maybe it's stupid.
It's
is it? Maybe it's the architecture of the database. I'm not a rocket scientist, I don't know. We are B2C. We are selling directly to the customers, and Kayak and SkyScanner is basically just forwarding the customers to us. So at the end, we are B2C.
They're forwarding their customers to you.
Yep.
How? For the completion at the end of the.
You click on a search result on Kayak, and you get forwarded to SkyPicker.
And for airlines that don't want to pay affiliate fees, what's the business logic for sending the traffic?
They just pay. we set our own margin, so we are selling the airline tickets, but we add some margin there.
Okay, so the customer pays a slightly higher price.
Yes.
And you, okay, so that would mean that the customer would not necessarily see the payment page of the destination.
No.
They wouldn't see that. They would see your payment. You would extract that.
They don't even visit the airline website.
Okay.
They are
so
not right there.
They pay you, and then you facilitate.
Yes, exactly.
The execution, and then you're able to take the margin even for airlines that don't pay.
And we then have 24/7 support and some guarantee. If you miss your flight, we'll cover it. You just call us, and we'll solve anything for you.
Okay, so it's more about it's as much about the booking.
Yes.
As it is about
basically, we are
it's
just
more about the booking than the search.
Yes, we are a full service travel agent, so we handle your trip from the beginning until the end.
And how much of that is automated and how much is manual?
90% is automated, I would say, nowadays.
Okay. So even all like the multi-step booking, like are you traveling with anyone and enter your passport and all that, you're able to abstract that away?
No, we just input this to the booking form.
That's what I'm saying. When you ask that from your customer.
Yes.
More questions? Anyone?
So the question is basically why we did not choose AWS instead of bare metal, yeah? First of all, it was compared to the bare metal, it was expensive. And second, the performance was not like stable. It was dropping sometimes and it just did crazy things. It was much, much, much slower than bare metal RAID 10 built from custom picked SSDs. We had what?
You had what? Like on the master server, what do you add third layer, I mean the middle layer in your architecture?
What's the middle layer?
Middle.
What's the middle layer? We had master server, which was the bottleneck, yeah?
You had two pictures, one was the master server and the same server.
Yeah.
You had another picture
with the middle layer. Oh, I get it, yeah. So the question was why we added another layer of servers between our master and the slave servers, yeah? Because the master was not able to handle the networking between himself and 100 of slave servers, which were trying to download 100 megabytes per data per second. So the network card was like saying, please. The network was the bottleneck. Person. 60, 70, maybe 80 people.
80 people. And since you grew in 2 years, that size, how do you keep them educated? How do you get them educated? How do you get them to speak?
No. First of all, it's about hiring. I don't know how, but we hired really great managers. We hired them like always drunk. But we had really luck with hiring managers, and they were able to build their teams really fast and efficient. And now we are just fixing the broken processes and everything. It's not perfect, but we are getting there slowly. It's about people, always.
More questions come in.
Why is so much hate towards the master?
NoSQL.
Oh, well, MongoDB.
MongoDB. MongoDB was broken 2 years ago. I don't know the current state. It was totally like useless. Maybe it's good nowadays. I was using it for logs. It was even trying to lose some logs. Yeah, Elasticsearch is super fine.
Broken in what way? It's MongoDB.
Did broken by InDesign.
Yes. It's fixed. Well done. Missing data.
It was just telling you, hey, I just died. Please leave me alone. Or, hey, I don't have this data. But I told you this data. Data loss or just random crashes, nobody knows why, or we never figure out what happened, just crashed. Yeah, maybe nowadays it's fine, I just don't touch it anymore.
I think a question about SSDs then. So you don't use them anymore?
We are using them, but if we know that there will be a 24/7 like full load, we have to pick Intel 3700 or some maybe Samsungs, I don't know. I know the Intels are fine, but only one series of them.
Intel.
Yeah. I don't know the market anymore. 1 year ago it was Intel 3700.
When was this happening?
2015 from January to September maybe, and 2014.
Should work now.
Okay, whoever is not interested in OCR, character recognition with
Python implementation he can leave for a silicon drink about. Jokic is going to show you the way out. Whoever is interested in OCR, please stay. We're going to start in a minute. Please leave, whoever doesn't want to listen.
So. Works. So,
can everyone take a seat, please?
So I will talk about OCR in Python. It's really like very small project compared to the SkyPicker stuff. So, what is OCR? You probably know that it's optical heart recognition. So when you have a picture, you want to get strings from it. So what I want to use it for? I like to keep my finances in order. So I use apps like Wallet to manage my finances and everything, my pub expenses. But I want to do more detailed stuff. So when I go to groceries, I receive a bill. I have lots of products in there, their prices and everything, so I keep it, and then I want to, then I would like to digitize it and have it everything in database. So that's what I need it for, and I mean writing everything just from the bill is crazy. So I want to automate it, doing OCR and some automated scanner, and use it like that. So I will use the Tesseract is from Google. I mean, it's hosted on Google now, but it was developed by Hewlett Packard between years 1984 and 1995. They kept it closed source, and then on 1995 they show it somewhere. It showed good results, but they close it again, and it was dormant for 10 years, and then they released it as open source. So then Google took it. And now it's now you can install it on every Linux. It's really available everywhere. It's open source. You can see there are lots of supported languages, and there are even more. You can train for more languages, so it's like infinite. You can install the Tesseract really easily, but we want to use it with Python. Because you can just run Tesseract and some picture, and use like I want to get like this is a single character or this is a like whole page or whatever, but then it saves a TXT file. But we want to get it directly from Python. So there are lots of pip modules. So if you do pip search Tesseract, you probably get something like this. So I didn't even try every one of these. I tried. Tesseract, I think it's really simple because you have to have pillow module to load an image as a picture, and then pass it to Tesseract, and it works. But I choose text extract, so it's like text extract. So there is a URL for that. It seemed really easy, more easier than the others. So there is just supported extensions: GIF, JPEG, PDF, PNG, and TIFF. And they say it can do a lot more because it's the code is written easily, so you can implement it under extensions. So on Arch Linux, you can install it like that. So just you. Because Tesseract is directly in the repository, so you can just install it and then install any data from the languages I showed, and then you just install pip because it's not installed in clean install, and then you just install the extract. Then the usage looks like this: so you just import it. You can ask from IPython what's the syntax for the function. And then you just run the extract, bills, and the JPEG. And this is what it shows. So there is I will show you the picture what I was trying to extract from. So you will see how that works. And then you can also specify a language the encoding. So let's do some showcases now. So this is the picture I took on the way here. So it probably it looks something like this. It's took by my 5 megapixel old phone, so the quality is not perfect. So when I do this from too big screen, but let's try it. Yeah, because as you saw, this is not cropped properly. It has outsides. So if I zoom out a little bit, because there is all the space around, so it doesn't provide very good results, as you can see. So then I cropped it like that very easily in GIMP, and if I do that, it provides much better results. So in order to automate it, I would need to have some kind of image like processing before to have some kind of good images. So probably some scanner or something like that would be best. So as you can see, the quality is not perfect. I mean, it's pretty good, but it can be worse. And some characters are not recognized as it should, because you can see that O gets recognized as U and stuff. So I would need, for proper implementation, I would need some kind of filter, some kind of database. So it would look for these words, and if there will be just one character wrong, it will correct it to correct character. I also forgot to mention about the T-Select. You can read all about it, how it works, because compared to other OCR engines, it's quite different, because it's not being developed anymore, because there are many other paid OCR engines which are much better. But this is open source, so everybody can use it. So you can read it on the code Google. There is everything written how that works exactly. So anybody who cares about that might be interesting. Yeah. So what plans I have? I also wanted to So I want to have all the products in the database, then also add a price to them, and have some kind of price history. Then I can also have ENs, the code of the products, in the database, and then I can search online what was the real price history compared to my price history. Then I want to use Raspberry Pi with its new camera to have some kind of automated scanner. It's really like a fun project, because you can just use normal scanner, because why would you do such stuff, but why not? And yeah, then you can do lots of stuff. Once you have it in the database, you can just play with it. So it's really not much to show, but if you have any questions, I will keep working on this project, and then when there will be some alpha version, you can see it on my GitHub. And if anyone wants something like that, everything will be there. Yeah, I can also show you. Yeah, because you can just write some simple Python code to extract that image, and then you can extract date and time, then extract specific lines. Yeah, you can. It's really easy to use. So, but as you can see, there are lots of characters which has to be filtered. So it's not that easy really. But yeah, that's it. So any questions?
Questions?
No, no, no. know, this is a really hobby project because as far as I know, if you receive a bill, there is no other way. You just have it on paper. There is no way like you, here you have your data of your what you bought.
Well, I can see commercial case from
yeah, perhaps.
Kind of thing that people can use to
yeah, I worked in a they did inventories for shops. So it might be useful for some people if the company provided that, but I don't really go for this kind of just a hobby project to have my finances in stuff and learn stuff with Python and do it because I work in IBM. We don't use Python too much. We use Java and JavaScript, and I have to use Python to keep sane a little bit. So
because
Java and JavaScript, but we use like a 10-year-old implementation of Mozilla Rhino, and there are lots of issues, and it's kind of dead, and we will maybe switch to Python, but it's really a long run. And I don't see it like maybe in 2 years maybe, but if you would see what we have to deal with in there, it's not it's really not nice. Yeah, okay, you know. So I guess Andra. Well, the recipes, the bills, what I saw there, just simple product name and then the price. Maybe some character in between, but it's really simple like that. I didn't see any tables like that or anything. Maybe they are, and really that's what the database will be for, because then you will have like this is the ticket type from this shop and this is from year this. So then you can have like some kind of template. Which you will use for that image, and it should work.
Well, I think she asked actually about like does the program can recognize the spaces and form a table on for example tabs
sorry.
And spaces.
Yeah.
Export like a CSV or something.
I'm not sure if the table is recognized correctly, but there is definitely in the when I will. Show oh, the Tesseract help. Is it here? No, I just open. So, okay. So you have these page mode, and you can see that the default is to be fully automatic. But you can treat an image as a single text line or a single word. So it really matters how the page search mode will detect the image. The extract doesn't care about this. It will do automatic all the time. But you can specify it, because if you're interested in this, you can see at the code Google there is a PDF about this, how does it recognize, because you can have a newspaper with like columns. So it will detect one column, then the other. It will filter out the images. So I didn't talk about tables, but I guess if you have a like single line, then it will detect like this is a single line, and then you can replicate the table, I guess. Well. It should recognize only the characters, not like the table, like the corners or anything, because that should be ignored, because it's like not a character. So it has to be tried. I didn't try this for a table.
Any more questions? I have a question. How do you do automatic recognition of what it is? A date, time, date?
This is. What I showed is that I just catched the date day string and time string.
Yeah, is there any tool that you figure out?
No, it's like only if date in line. So it's really simple. Yeah, no, there is nothing, because as I said, it has to be template for the whole build, all the for the ticket type. Yeah, the regex.
Automatically figure out that, all right, that is a date type.
Yeah, the regex will be the best way, because I just did a quick showcase, but regex will be the best way, sure. Right. So where is Ondra?
Should be.
That's it. No.
Yummy.
Yes.
Oh, no. Okay, so hi guys. I'll try to make it quick because I think you're more like looking for the beer. But it will be kind of 10 minutes talk, kind of a case study or demo of BigML. Actually, yeah. Do you know what is decision tree? How many of us? Okay. For those who heard it for the first time, this is kind of decision tree. It is a tree, and you can choose some path and end in some category. Yeah, what I'm going to show you about BigML is how to build a decision tree with some data. It is basically some simple implementation of machine learning. So we used it once in SkyPicker. I can show you how. Now I can choose some flight I want to book, but I'm offline, I suppose. Okay. Okay, let's say you are a guy who wants to book a flight and fill the title, your name, and credit card, and so on, and pay for it. It happened that about 0.5% people have a bad credit card. It's a fraud payment. So in little cases, it happens that the payment looks like okay, but one or few days later, the bank says, okay, that the payment is cancelled and you don't got any money. So we are now paying quite a lot money to the insurance against these cases. So one of the use cases we used the BigML was trying to figure out if the payments
will be fraud payment or not before it actually happened. So this case we use it was to use the name and the nationality and the credit card number to guess if the customer will price change. If the customer actually is kind of correct customer or just a fraud customer. I'm not going to show you the data because it's a kind of a secret. But when I processed the data from it, it was kind of clear that I have an image. It told me how the typical fraud looks like. It's a guy. His title is Mr. He booked on one flight, and the user agent does not contain Apple WebKit. He doesn't use macOS. The phone number starts with some prepositions, which is from some weird countries. He doesn't use Gmail, and he booked at SkyPicker, and there is his age. This is a typical fraud, and yeah. As I can't show you the data, but I can show you another data with to demo the big ML. Okay, this is another case. You can imagine a service where a bunch of botanists can tell you the name of the plant if you show them a photo of a plant. This is actually a real service, and there is an application for a mobile, and you can just take a picture, send it to the botanist, and sometimes, it's about 90% of cases, they can tell you if what plant it is. So in this case, it would be resolved. This data we have, it's a question of a customer, the country of a customer, when the request for plant identification was created, the platform, iOS or Android, plant type, set up by the customer, how many images the customer sent, and if it was after correct resolved identified by the botanist. You can see that sometimes it wasn't resolved. They just didn't know, they couldn't answer him. Okay, I have this data, it's 57,000 of records, and 90 of them was identified plants. And now I want to predict in which countries we are strong, or the botanists are strong, or which platforms, or maybe which type of plant they can identify better or not. So it can help the botanist to focus on some countries or platforms or so on. Okay, I have a CSV file here. No, that's a big query, no big ML. I just put it here. Okay, now it's a 5 megabytes of data. Now, this is the same data, but it is rotated. You can see the name of the columns here. And this is the question, country, and so on. And now the next step, when I have the data uploaded, would be the create a data set from the source. So I can just click create data set. You can notice that I'm not in sources, but I have switched to the data set. Okay. This is the first cool thing about BigML. I can see the distribution of values. This is the length of the questions. There are a few long questions. For example, there are 3 platforms. This is Android. This is the most used, iOS. And I don't know what it is. This is elevation of the plant, where it was taken, if it was in mountains or sea level, plant type. We can have garden plant here. This is the most popular category, indoor plant, wild plant, and so on. This is the hour of the day. So, yeah, another cool fact is that there was a timestamp originally in the data, this timestamp, and the BigML just create another values for me, just the day hour, day of the week, and so on. They behave with like it was an individual attribute. Okay, now I have a data set, I want to create a model. Oh, there is another cool stuff I can show you. I like it when I don't have any idea about data. This is a graph, and I can choose dimensions. For example, I have a country here. There are so much countries. Maybe platform would be better. No, plant type. And for example, images count. You can just choose the dimensions, and you can see how much records will be in the category defined by the axis. For example, most of the plants don't have any defined plant type. And this is garden plants with just one image included. And also I can choose a third dimension for a color. This is month, and so on. Maybe I could see that the indoor plant would be most popular in winter when I choose month. Yeah. You can see that the different plant categories are popular in different times. In the different month in the year. Okay, but it was just interesting exploration. Now I'm going to create a model. It is represented by a decision tree, and I have to say what is the objective field. For me, if it has been resolved or not. I'm trying to predict if it would be resolved based on these attributes or not. So this is cool. The big ML guessed correctly that I'm going to predict the resolved value. And I can configure the size of the decision tree. Let's say I want to have a small tree, 18 nodes. Okay. It will take about Now I have a decision tree, and I can see what is the most important rule to decide if it would be resolved or not. Now I can see it's a month of the year. I suppose it is because in the summer there is a lot of plants and the botanists don't have time to resolve everything, so in the summer, yeah, it starts in April. When it's beginning of the year, it goes this way, and I can see on the leaf if this category, if it will be resolved probably or not. I can see the confidence here. So it means it will be resolved based if these attributes are okay, it will be probably resolved with 85% probability. Actually, it is not a pretty good data set, because when I checked all the leaves, it will be resolved every time. That's because the data set is really unbalanced. If I check the raw data, I can see there is so little unresolved cases. So it's logical that the classifier will try to every time predict that it will be resolved. But I can change the view. Let's say I'm looking on the tree, but from the side, and now I will see it from up there. This way. This is the root, and I can go through the branches here. Now I can do see the difference of the colors. I can see here. This is a little low confidence. So there's also a lower confidence in when this case are here. So the bad thing is that in this case I have a really low confidence. If the photo was taken sooner than August, when the plant is not indoor plant, that the confidence of it will be resolved is only 70%. But let's say this way, there is a much better confidence, 92%. Let's say, what is the most important factor to decide the confidence? I can check this one. I can see what is the most important factor. It is the month. And then it is the plant type. As you could see from the branches, if the plant type is wild, the probability that it will be resolved is much lower. And these two factors are the most important. I didn't know that before I did this analysis. Okay. Let's do some other stuff with the data. Let's say I want to test it, how good it is. So I can split the data set into two data sets. One is training and one will be testing. Now it's kind of slow, but it depends on your pricing model. For me, it is free, so it takes a few seconds. Okay. Now I have a sample. Now you can see that it has been split to 80 training set and testing set, which is kind of lower. And what I do now, I'll create another model only for the 80% of the data. Just a small one. And I'm going to do the trick that I will balance the data. Now, if I choose, I want to balance objective, now it will take the same amount of data from the resolved ones and unresolved ones. So we will actually see the results in the tree. Okay, I'll create a model. Now, in this case, it wouldn't be resolved. If it is in summer and the plant type is indoor. Now in this case there is a one down there, it will be resolved. Yep, cool. Now I want to test it against the test set. No. Evaluate. Okay, that's cool. I've pre-selected the model and the sample sets, the test set, and I can do the evaluation just one click. Okay, now I can see that the accuracy is 50%. It is not much. there is a precision F measure recall, so statistical stuff, you know, you probably know from. Okay, and I can see another statistical stuff. I can see that my model is slightly better than the random distribution, than the random tree, because the tree is very small, but it's better than nothing. And of course, I can see the confusion matrix here. And also, when I check the boilerplate and switch it from the confidence, now it's coloring by the confidence, but I want to color it by prediction. Now I can see the cases where it won't be resolved here, and it will be resolved. Yeah. Fine. So that's how you can just create the tree. You can see the rules and understand the problem. And let's say, okay, I have the tree, but I want to use it. I want to use it in production to decide if the botanist will resolve it properly or not, or if the payment is fraud or not. So I want to use it in my code. Somewhere here was, okay, actionable model download. I'll just select Python and I'll see the whole code. I can just copy paste in my project, and it is the whole function predict resolved, and it's behaving basically like the tree you can see here. So in 5 minutes you can create classifier, validate it, and download the bunch of Python code which will behave exactly like the tree you can see here. So yeah, when I saw this tool, I said, okay, we are going to use it, and actually we are using it in some cases, and it's actually great also for the data exploration analysis that I have shown you before. Fine, I think I've covered, yeah, everything I want to say. Do you have any questions about BKML? Or you want to go for a beer?
Maybe everybody here, just take a little beer. Questions, guys? All right. Then Andre, thank you very much.
Yeah, I think.